Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this little tutorial on the little 555 timer. Now this came about because of the look inside video that I did on that little Kelty lamp. So we ended up with the situation where I had a problem because there was a leakage current. It was a very small surface mount kind of circuit, so it was difficult for me to troubleshoot. And someone suggested putting it on a breadboard and taking it from there. So that's exactly what I've done. It's led me down a little bit of a rabbit hole because it's opened up a few little interesting challenges in terms of getting the circuit together, and then some interesting opportunities which we'll look at in part two once we look at the actual practical exercise and how that circuit works. So in part one, what we're going to do, I'm going to quickly show you the circuit, and then we're going to go over some theory about the makeup of a 555 timer and then how each of those circuits work. There's a latched switch circuit, and then there's the pulse width modulation switch, which actually drives LED, which allows you to change or alter the brightness of the LED using pulse width modulation. Now there's a fair bit to cover off. This is perhaps a little tutorial which I would have hoped to have done after I'd completed transistors and perhaps got into some logic gates. But nonetheless, it's an interesting exercise. For those of you who are doing the kind of basic stuff, you may well get lost or not quite get everything first time around. There's a fair bit to explain because we kind of go through op amps or comparators, an RS flip-flop to understand the way the actual 555 timer works. So that can get quite confusing trying to follow all the electrical paths and the logic inside a 555 timer. But don't worry, the best thing to do is actually have fun with it. You don't have to fully understand the theory to have fun. Put it on a breadboard and start playing with it. And if you do put it on a breadboard and start playing with it and just take away a few facts or a little bit of information from this video, when we eventually get to logic gates and registers and the like, you'll have some seeds which are sitting there, which will then kind of add some theory to the little bit of practice that you've done on the bench. Now, the 555 timer is a very popular chip. They sell over 1 billion per annum. It was invented back in 1971. It's been around a fair while, and it still forms the basis of many people's home projects and even commercial electronics. Although in commercial electronics, what they tend to move is using programmable chips. But nonetheless, believe it or not, there is also a programmable version of the 555 timer. We'll talk about the different variants of a 555 timer in part two when we actually have a closer look at the circuit and perhaps try and resolve a little issue or challenge that this circuit also has, like the Kelty lamp, with a bit of leakage current. But anyway, let's just have a quick look at it and then jump into the theory. Right, so right at the heart of the two circuits we're going to discuss today is the 555 timer. So in this package over here, it's a DIP dual inline package with 8 pins, and we're going to go around and discuss what the pins do and how it operates. But it is made up of 25 transistors, 2 diodes, and 15 resistors. So there's a fair bit that goes to making up this package. It comes in different types. You can get it in surface mount. This is just one single 555 timer. You get it in ICs which give you 2 or even 4 555 timers. And in fact, the circuit that I've built where I make use of 2 circuits could have been done with a single IC with perhaps 2 or more 555 timers on it. The circuit that I've got thrown together on the breadboard is similar to the one that was kind of operating that Kelty lamp. I've got a momentary push switch located over here. The 555 timer is in the middle of the circuit over here. We've got a transistor, various supporting components, resistors and capacitors, as you'll realize are the important timing components around a 555 timer. So this circuit is the latched switch, and the circuit on this side over here driving the LED does the pulse width modulation, where we can change the brightness of the LED more efficiently than, let's say, doing a resistor, which is going to burn off and waste energy. There is a little multi-turn pot over here on the circuit, which allows us to adjust the duty cycle of the pulse width modulation, which allows us to change the brightness of the LED. So if I go and switch the momentary switch, you see it latches, it turns the LED off and turns it back on again. But we're going to have a closer look and have a look at on an oscilloscope to see the operation and the actual output of the light of the LED, how that's affected by the pulse width modulation. Right, so as I said, the 555 timer was invented by a gent by the name of Hans Kammerzint, if I've got the pronunciation correct, in 1971.
As I said, 25 transistors, 2 diodes, and 15 resistors are what make up its internals. But the high level components are simply a set of voltage dividers, 3 resistors, 2 comparators or op amps, and then an RS flip-flop, and then a transistor and an inverter. But we're going to talk a little bit about this detail because sometimes it's represented a little differently. That layout on the actual 555 timer itself, if we put the IC this way, we've got the little tab which denotes the kind of first pin on this side over here. So we've got pins 1, 2, 3, 4 on the one side and then 6, 7, 8 on the other. The first pin, pin 1, is a ground for VCC or the supply voltage, and then pin 8 is the positive for VCC, and that's that pin over here. As I continue to talk about the pinout, you'll see I do have them labeled on this diagram, and obviously that refers to the layout around the actual IC itself. Okay, the one little interesting fact to point out about the 555 timer is that it's got these 3 5K resistors inside which act as voltage dividers. So you'll note 555, and it's one way to remember perhaps their values. They're each 5K, and it's a thought that perhaps the name of the 555 timer came from those 3 voltage dividers, 555. But apparently when asked, Hunt said no. The name wasn't derived from those 3. It's just an arbitrary number that he had in his head, and he decided to call it the 555 timer. So as noted, the first kind of key part to the 555 timer are these 3 5K resistors, and they act as voltage dividers for the kind of key voltage levels which are held and set at these 2 op amps. Now the first op amp is held at a level of a third VCC. So on this little voltage divider over here, you can see we've got a takeoff from the voltage divider which goes into the positive input of the op amp or the comparator, and that's at a third VC. So your VCC is obviously cross pins 8 and 1, so that's at a third VCC. And up here at this comparator, we've got the voltage from the voltage divider over here brought in at this point onto the negative or inverting side of the comparator, and that is held at 2/3 of VCC. Now as noted, we've got the 2 op amps, they feed into an RS flip-flop. The comparators, and again we're going to go into more detail about their operation further in the electronic series, but their basic operation is that you're going to have an input and it compares the input and adjusts the output to either a high or low according to the input. Now the output will follow what the input, the highest level of the input, and in that regard, so if we look at the bottom comparator here, if your voltage level is higher on the positive input than it is the negative, then your output is going to go high. If your voltage level is higher on the negative input versus the positive input, then your output is going to go low. The top one operates the same, but obviously it's hooked up differently because the external input from to this op amp comes in on the positive side, and on the lower op amp it comes in on pin 2, which is the trigger, and that comes in on the negative side. Both of these feed into an RS flip-flop, and we're going to have a closer look at the flip-flop and understand how the logic and how it works. And then the output of the actual flip-flop goes through to a transistor which operates a discharge pin, pin 7. So depending on where the output of the flip-flop, it's either going to switch the transistor on and allow discharge through to ground through pin 7, or it's going to be switched off. But when this is switched off, the output pin 3 is high. So these kind of operate opposite to each other. Now the interesting thing again, once we get down to the understandings of an RS flip-flop, is you're going to have an output, and these outputs are known as Q and not Q. So not Q is either the opposite or the inverse or the complementary to what's happening on Q. Now, in many diagrams, and I still don't know which is correct, you'll sometimes find the output of this Q going directly to the output. This is an inverter. So basically, if we take it that the output is coming from not Q, it goes through, so if we've got high coming through here and setting a bias on the transistor, It comes through here as a high, but then it gets inverted by this inverter and comes out as a low over here. Now in theory, if you wanted opposites coming out, you could take straight from Q as opposed to going from here. And I think the logic is, if you end up in an illegal state on the RS flip-flop for some reason, there are certain states which aren't allowed on the flip-flop. And if you have one of those or noise or something happening, then at least it's only happening on the single pin and these will always be opposite to each other. Whereas if you had that coming out directly from Q, you could have a situation where these aren't operating opposite from each other. That's my little thumb suck, but as I say, you will see if you go and have a look at diagrams, some just take an output straight from Q to the output, no inverter, and then not Q drives the transistor. A couple of other pins we haven't mentioned is pin 4, which is a reset, which resets the flip-flop and the entire chip state. And that, if it's tied to, normally what you do is you tie this to your VCC, your positive input, you keep it high, then it's not going to reset. If you wanted to reset the actual chip or the flip-flop itself, you take it low to actually reset the actual state of the flip-flop. The other pin we haven't mentioned, which is not used very frequently, is pin 5, the control pin. And that literally can be used to change the setup of the internal voltage dividers. But you'll often find the circuits that I've seen thus far don't make use of that. We don't make use of it in the two circuits that I'm going to demonstrate. This pin should be tied to ground with a decoupling capacitor. Now you'll note in one of the circuits I don't have that, but it is best practice to actually do that. So it's something to note for later. The trigger and threshold pins, which we're going to talk more about, these often, and in my circuits, are tied together. And then we just obviously have 3, which is your main output. Your main output, if I'm correct, can drive up to 200 milliamp, but you need to go and have a look at the spec sheet, because I say there are different variants of the 555 timer. The 555 timer operates on around 4.5 to 16 volts. Before we get stuck into the operation and how I've got it working one of the circuits, let's just go have a look at the operation of these two comparators and the RS flip-flop. Right, so let's have a look at the RS flip-flop. A really little handy device. As I said, we are going to be looking at counters, registers, and logic gates. And this is one of them we will certainly look at. And in fact, what I hope to do in the future is build something like these RS flip-flops and comparators out of discrete components. So once we get to that point, I think it'll be a good learning exercise that we actually build these out of discrete components so that we get a real good understanding of how they work internally as well. Now what I've done here to explain the logic and how the flip-flop works, and in particular in respect to the 555 timer, I've got this simple diagram of just the RS flip-flop and the two comparators. Now in this diagram, what you will note if you had a sharp eye, the positive and negatives are the other way around. Doesn't matter, it's just I decided to draw it this way. You can draw them either way. And then I've noted here we've got 2/3 VCC, which is, remember, what these are tied to, because those 3 5K resistors, the voltage dividers, tie this, the negative or inverting side of this op amp, to 2/3 VCC as a reference. And then on the bottom comparator, the positive input is tied to 1/3 VCC. So these are reference voltages which are held by that resistor network from your supply voltage. Then externally, we've got pins both 6 and 2, which in my case, an explanation here, we're tying together because that's how they're operating in the two circuits, and we're going to call that V trigger. Now this V trigger, the voltage level which is coming in here, and this is the kind of magic about the 555 timer, you can make the 555 timer do all kinds of things and behave in different ways depending on how you hook it up and the timing or the resistors and capacitors that you put in on this side. So what we basically, all we're doing is having capacitors and resistors to provide a timing via voltage level, which is going to go up, stay the same, or come back down to provide the logic which comes into the two comparators, which feeds our RS flip-flop, which then provides us with an output. So if we go through that operation, let's first of all understand what the comparators are going to output before we understand the logic of the actual RS flip-flop. If we have a voltage level over here, let's pretend that we've got a VCC of 6 volts across here. So that means at a third VCC, this is going to be sitting at 2 volts. And at 2/3 VCC, we're going to be sitting at 4 volts with our VCC equal to 6 volts. Now, if we have our components and our capacitors on the outside, which are slowly filling up as our timing device, so we've got a voltage level that's increasing at a certain rate, while it's below 2 volts, we're going to have a situation where we've got a low voltage coming in on the inverting side of the comparator. So the positive side, which is sitting at 2 volts, is going to be higher. And as we said, the voltage is going to follow the higher level of the input. And because our high level is on the positive input, we're going to get a high out. We're going to call it 1 for the high. And on the upper comparator, that is also going to be, because it's tied to the same input, is going to be lower than 4 volts, obviously. That voltage is coming in on the positive side, and because it's lower and we've got a higher voltage sitting at 4 volts sitting on the negative, it's going to follow that inverted or negative input, and it's going to be 0. So here we can see in different situations, depending on the voltage level coming into your 555 timer, you're going to get certain logic coming out your comparator, which is fed into the RS flip-flop. So in this case, we have a 0 and a 1. As that voltage increases and we surpass the 2 volt level, we then get a situation where, because we've got a greater voltage on the inverting side, the negative, it's going to follow that. That's going to change to a low or 0 output. At this point in time, we've still got the same situation on the upper comparator because the voltage hasn't yet reached 4 volts. So it is going to be, the higher voltage is still on the negative input, so it is also going to have a 0. So we have a situation then when we have a 0 and a 0. The other state is then when our voltage level surpasses the 2/3 VCC, so we're above 4 volts because our capacitor is, let's say, charging up, our external timing circuit is at that level. And when that hits that point, we obviously already passed that on this comparator over here. So we were at 0, it's still going to be 0. The level on the negative input is greater than the 2 volts, so it follows, it's 0. And then on the top comparator, now we've got a greater voltage on the positive input than the negative, so it goes to 1. So we've got a situation where the input here is now 1 and 0. So those are the different states according to the voltage levels of our timing circuit on the outside of the 555 timer. Remember, this part is obviously on the inside of the 555 timer. So now we have this wonderful device called the RS flip-flop. Now the RS comes from, the R stands for reset and the S stands for set. It's as simple as that. And then we've got an output of Q, which is the kind of normal output, if you will. And then we have not Q, or the complement or the inverse. And we're going to get the opposite result coming out here. Now remember, don't get too confused. Remember, this is different from the setup I showed you on the previous page, but to avoid confusion of working with the inverse, we're going to work with a normal output, which, if you're looking at pin 3, because that there's that inverter on pin 3, you're actually seeing the logic which would in theory be coming out of the Q output. So let's understand how the RS flip-flop works. Now in basic terms, basically when you've got a logic high on the R or reset, you're resetting the state of the flip-flop, and you're going to reset it to an output of 0. If you've got a logic high on the set, well then you're going to set the output of the flip-flop to a logic high or a 1. There is another logic state, and that's kind of a memory state where it remembers the last state it was in. And this is quite important because on a lot of the descriptions of these circuits that I looked at, they kind of explained the circuit, but because they didn't mention this kind of memory state of the RS flip-flop, that was kind of brushed over. So it's nice and handy to have an understanding of that, because otherwise when you follow through the logic of what's happening on your circuit as a voltage level rises on the input of the trigger, they kind of miss this one with the memory state. And the memory state is when both of these are set to 0. So when you get a logic 0, 0 coming in on the input of your flip-flop, it will maintain the previous state. So whatever your output was, whether it was a 1 or a 0, it'll hold it at that level. And that's important because on the latching circuit, that certainly plays a critical part. If we have a look at this table, and this is how when we look at some logic gates and how they work, we set up a table to understand how they work. And I've got the three columns. One is understanding at what level the voltage trigger is at, and then the corresponding outputs from the comparators which feed the reset and set, so your RS. And then your output, which is known as Q, I've got it as Qn here because it's a state of Q, and the reason it's plus one because that's the next state that your flip-flop is going to go to when it sees this input. So as I described, the first level, we've got our V trigger. When your V trigger is less than a third VCC, so as I said, your lower level below 2 volts in this example, when we're at that point, we said we've got a 0 and a 1, got 0, 1 going into RS. And as I said, because we've got the high on the set value, our output from the flip-flop is going to go high. It's going to be 1. Then we've got our other state when we're in the middle. We've gone higher than the 2 volts. So V trigger is greater than a third VCC, but less than 2/3 VCC. And in that case, we end up with a situation from our comparators where we've got a 0 and a 0, 0, 0 to the reset and set. And as I noted before, that's our memory state. So that is Qn. It'll remain at whatever state it was. And if, as in this example, if we're following the table, it was at 1, well, then the output in this case would be 1. If it happened to be the previous state was different and it was 0, it would be 0 over here. We then reach our other state where obviously our voltage level has now surpassed the 4 volts, where our trigger is greater than 2/3 VCC, and that obviously implies you're greater than a third VCC. And in that case, we get a situation where we've obviously got the high coming out of this comparator, 0 there, so 1, 1, 0 going into our flip-flop. And as noted, we've got a 1 on the reset, so it's going to reset it back to a 0. So that term flip-flop is literally because it kind of flip-flops, it changes between states according to the two inputs on the reset and set. And that's the basis of how the 555 timer works. Obviously, depending on how you configure the external components for the timing and the states that it's going to put the RS flip-flop into. This level of logic doesn't have to follow the sequence. It depends what you're doing on the outside of the actual 555 timer.